Everybody to this Analysis Junior Seminar. Today we have Moreno Pintore from Politecnico di Torino. I will remind to everybody that this seminar will be recorded and updated in our SIAM chapter YouTube channel. And regarding this, also I ask you if you're interested to join SIAM and especially subscribe to our SIAM chapter. It's a big opportunity to interact with other people all around the world in the SIAM community, and also to follow us in our activities from the AGS seminar, partially organized by the SIAM chapter, and also, for example, the SIAM chapter colloquia and the CISA Women in Mathematics colloquia. So please subscribe. And if you're interested, join our community. So today we have Moreno Pintore. He will talk to us about variational physics in form neural networks, and in particular the role of quadratures and test functions. Moreno, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. As Francesco said, I'm a PhD student at Politecnico di Torino, and today we'll present you a work done in collaboration with my supervisors, Professor Stefano Berrone and Claudio Canuto. And the main topic is an a priori error estimate for variational physics informed neural networks. In particular, these error estimates will be based on the order of the quadrature rules and of the test functions that are involved in the construction of the loss function. Just a brief introduction for the one of you who don't know what physics informed neural networks are. In practice, they are neural networks that are trained to approximate the solution of partial differential equations. Let us consider, just to give you an example, a simple case. This Poisson problem with Dirichlet boundary conditions. The exact solution is U. We want to compute a function U and N that is the output of a neural network, which input are, for instance, the spatial coordinates of the domain. In order to train the network, obviously, we need a loss function here called L. And as you can see, this is the sum between the residual of the equation and the residual of the boundary condition on two given set of control points. If all these residuals are very small, we can think that we have a good approximation of our solution. However, due to the fact that the number of control points is obviously limited, we cannot ensure any sort of reliability on the numerical approximation of the exact solution that we are computing. To ensure some sort of control, instead, we need to change a little bit the setting. So considering a variational physics-informed neural network, and also we will use an interpolation operator in order to stabilize the neural network. Then obviously one can choose to consider more complex problems, for instance, changing the definition of the residuals in order to introduce some nonlinearities, or to add some parameters that can be inserted in the input of the neural network together with the spatial coordinates or temporal coordinate. And also one can consider high dimensional problems that can be managed by the neural network because they can overcome the curse of dimensionality. However, in this presentation, we will simply focus on a classical second order elliptic problem with known parameters. This is our problem of interest. It is defined on a polygonal or polyhedral domain in Rn. And these are all classical assumptions for the well-posedness of the problem. I only highlight that we denote as a U hat the extension of the Dirichlet boundary data on the entire domain omega. This is a function in H1. And will be used as a lifting function to impose the Dirichlet boundary conditions. As I said, we want to consider a variational physics-informed neural network, and to do so, we have to consider the variational formulation of the previous problem. We thus choose proper functional spaces that are H1 denoted as U, and its restriction to the set of functions in H1 and vanishing on the Dirichlet boundary that is denoted as V. Then we can consider the standard bilinear form A and linear form F defined in this way to define our variational formulation that is a classical Galerkin formulation. Note that here we are considering the affine space defined by the lifting function plus the space V. This can be done very easily in, for instance, finite element method. However, for a neural network, it's not so easy to consider a function in this space. And to do so, we consider an additional operator that will be called B, that maps functions in H1, U, in functions in the affine space that we are interested in. To do so, given an input W, we multiply it by a smooth function in V, and then we sum the lifting function. In this way, we are automatically enforcing the Dirichlet boundary condition on the output of our neural network, that in practice will be W. The corresponding variational formulation is similar to the previous one, but it exploits the operator B, is this one, is equivalent to the previous one, but now we want to solve a Petrov-Galerkin problem because the spaces here and here are different. Before talking about our error estimate, I need to introduce some more ingredients. First of all, we need the two conforming shape regular and nested triangulations, T capital H and TH. They have to be similar in the sense that the mesh sizes have to be compatible. Then we need the two approximate forms AH and FH that respectively approximate A and F. They have to be computable element-wise and with the quadrature rules of order Q. Here Q is a parameter that we can set at the beginning of the training. Then we need the two linear subspaces, UH and VH, that are subspaces of U and V, and made of piecewise polynomials of order k-int and k-test, and are defined over the two triangulations. Now, to ensure good approximation properties, we want the two spaces to have the same dimension, and also k-int and k-test have to satisfy this relation. Finally, we need an interpolation operator, ih, that maps continuous functions to functions in UH, so piecewise polynomials of order k-int. This is a classical interpolation operator, and therefore we will use some classical error estimates to control it. Our neural network instead is a very standard, fully connected feed-forward neural network, and therefore its output can be seen as the composition of multiple nonlinearities to the input vector, that in our case contains only the spatial coordinates of the problem. I remark that we denote as U and N the set of functions that can be exactly generated by a neural network with a fixed architecture. However, note that this is a set of functions and it is not a functional space. Now we want to connect our neural network with the variational problem, and therefore we can write this new problem that is similar to the previous one, but we look for a solution in the space U and N, so the functions generated by the neural network, and in the equation we want to compute the approximate solution starting from the output of a neural network, enforcing the Dirichlet boundary conditions, and then interpolating the results. In order to train the network to be the solution of this problem, as in the non-variational physics-informed neural network, we want to consider a set of residuals and then minimize them. The residuals that we want to consider are the ones corresponding to the functions in a basis of VH, so can be defined in this way. And then the loss function is simply a linear combination of the squared residuals. Here, one could use any linear combinations. However, we will use only gamma equal one. Now, before finally deriving our a priori error estimate, we need three preliminary assumptions. And here, and also later on, we will denote as k any integer that is between 1 and k int. The error estimates will be related to the greater k that satisfy all the assumptions. The first one is on the data smoothness. In fact, we require these regularities for the data of our equation, and just for the sake of brevity, we group their norms under these two symbols. Then we need an if subcondition that have to hold between the spaces UH0 and VH. Here UH0 is the intersection between UH and V. So the functions in VH in UH that vanish on the Dirichlet boundary. And finally, we also need some smoothness for the solution of the problem and also for the space UNN. This is the main results of our work, these an a priori error estimates. They state that if UHNN is computed in this way, so coherently with our variational problem, then the difference in the H1 norm between the exact solution and the numerical one can be controlled in this way. This is a product between three terms. The third one can be considered constant because it only depends on the data of the equation. The second one is associated with the convergence rate of the method, that is k. And then this first term is a term that may depend on h, and in this way it could ruin our convergence rate that otherwise would be k. Let's start from this term. The true constants CH are the constants that are present in the norm equivalence between the space H1 and the discrete weighted L2 space associated with the vectors that are the coefficients of the function VH with respect to some basis. However, we know from classical results that when a Lagrange basis is used, and the corresponding mesh is quasi uniform, then the ratio between these two constants scales as h to the power minus one. And therefore, here we are ruining the convergence rate of exactly one order because of the presence of this term. Now I would like to give you an idea of the proof of the theorem. And to do so, I need two preliminary results. The first one is about the approximation of the forms A and F. In fact, we can define the consistency errors that are due to the numerical quadratures as the difference between the exact and the approximate forms. And it is possible to prove, exploiting the fact that k int plus k test is equal to q plus 2, it is possible to generalize classical finite element results and prove that the consistency errors scales as h to the power k. Then, using these results and also the previous assumptions, one can prove that the if subcondition holds also when the form A is substituted by the form AH. Now I would start to give you an idea of the proof. We want to control this quantity, and to do so, we use the triangle inequality. To do so, we introduce a new element, UH, that is a suitable element in the affine subspace defined as UH bar, the interpolation of the lifting function, plus UH0. However, we know that UHNN, our solution, can be written in the same way. and therefore the difference between these two functions belongs to UH0. We can thus apply the discriminative subcondition to control their difference, that is this last norm in equation 5, and we would like to get rid of the dependence of VH, somehow obtaining it in the numerator to simplify it with the denominator. To do so, we start by manipulating the numerator in this way, and we want to control it with the triangle inequality, controlling each term. The third one can be controlled by the continuity of A. The last two terms can be controlled using the consistency error estimates, and we only have to focus on the first two terms. However, here we recognize the definition of the residual against the test function VH that can be written in this way as a discrete L2 scalar product. Therefore, we can use Cauchy-Schwarz to control that quantity, obtaining the norm of the coefficients of VH. And since we wanted to simplify the H1 norm of VH, we have to introduce also the constant CH of the norm equivalence. Combining everything together, we obtained equation 7 that obviously depends on the choice of UH. However, we can choose UH to be the one that minimizes this quantity. Then, to obtain this infimum. Then, exploiting the fact that U belongs to H K plus 1, we can choose UH to be the interpolation of U, obtaining these two error estimates for the two norms that depend on UH present in equation 7. In this way, we can get rid also of the dependence of UH, obtaining this partial result, that is this lemma, and is very close to what we want to prove. In fact, as you can see, we are controlling our error with something that scales as h to the power k plus a term that depends on the loss function evaluated on our solution. Note that if for some reason we know that this quantity is negligible, then we already proved our results. In any other case, instead, we want also to control the loss function for our solution. To do so, we use the optimality condition that ensures us that the loss function evaluated on our solution has to be lower or equal than the loss function evaluated on any other function of the space U and N. Now, if we are able to control the right-hand side for a given function, we can simply control with that quantity also our quantity of interest. Then we focus on the loss function evaluated on W and N. It can be written thanks to the definition of the dual norm in this way. We can expand the residuals as the difference between FH and AH, and as previously done, we want to substitute the norm of the coefficients of ZH with the H1 norm of the corresponding function, but to do so we have to introduce the quantity 1 over CH. Now we want to control the quantity in the brackets in order to simplify this denominator. Then, just for the sake of brevity, we will denote this quantity IH, B, W, and N as WH and N. We wanted to control the difference between FH and AH. However, they can be written in these two ways. And to control the difference, we can control the difference between all the terms. The first two terms can be controlled, their difference can be controlled by means of the continuity of the form A, while the last two terms can be controlled using the consistency error estimates. Then we can control the quantity RH, W, and N in this way, but this depends obviously on the function W and N in these two norms. We want also to control these two norms. To do so, we introduce a new quantity, ENN, defined as U minus BWNN. And here one can prove that one can obtain this identity. So controlling, writing in a different way the argument of the first norm. And this quantity can be controlled by means of the triangle inequality. Obviously, there will be some norms of the function ENN. Then we want also to control WHNN. This is the triangle inequality for the first norm. And to control the norm of WHNN, we can simply use a standard inverse inequality in a finite element method to obtain this control. Note that we are controlling both the norms with something that depends on the exact solution U and with something that depends on the quantity ENN. However, we found in this paper that for neural network with an architecture equivalent to the one that we used, it is possible to prove that the best approximation error for fixed size neural network decreases exponentially with the dimension of the network itself. Therefore, it is always possible to have a network that is large enough to satisfy a constraint of this form for any seminorm of the function ENN. This constraint is not restrictive because the fact that the error decreases exponentially ensures us that a network large enough is not so large because we are comparing an exponential convergence with an algebraic convergence that we wanted to obtain. And this function always exists. Then we can see we only have to consider that specific function in the previous inequality, substituting the seminorms of ENN with the corresponding quantities thanks to equation 12, and obtain this control that allows us to control the loss function evaluated on our neural network. Then we use the fact that the two mesh sizes are compatible, and we can combine these last results with the lemma, this one where we only needed to control the loss function, in order to completely control our error. However, here we have this capital CH, and here we have 1 over CH, and therefore we obtain that constant CH over CH that scales as h to the power minus 1. Note also that the assumption that the two mesh sizes are compatible is not restrictive. In fact, the two meshes are nested, and it is always possible to generate the first mesh and then refine it to obtain the second one. Now I would like to show you some numerical results. They are obviously related to this equation that we analyzed. In the first two test cases, we considered a very smooth function. In the first case, we have a one-dimensional problem, but with variable coefficients. In the second case, we have a constant coefficient, but Dirichlet and Neumann boundary condition on a two-dimensional domain. And these are the error decays that we obtained. Just a brief description of these pictures. In Black, we always have the data for our interpolated neural network. And in green, we have the data for a non-interpolated neural network. This is not included in our theory. However, it is useful to note that even though the theory is not related to this kind of network, the behaviors of the black and green dots is always very close. Then we have the solid lines that are the regression lines for the corresponding points. And the black dashed line is a line which slope is equal to k. So the predicted convergence rate neglecting the term ch over ch. Here and also later on, we have on the left quadrature rules of order q equal 3 and test functions of order k test equal 1. Therefore, k int, the interpolation order has to be 4, and the 4 is also the expected convergence rate. In the middle, instead, we increase q from 3 to 5, and on the right, we increase k test from 1 to 2. As you can see, when k test is equal to 1, we obtain an empirical convergence rate that is always very close to k, the predicted one. Instead, when k test is equal to 2, we have a discrepancy of exactly one order, and this is due to the presence of the term ch over ch that here cannot be neglected. Similar results hold also when we consider the second test case. We are here in a two-dimensional problem, and therefore the data is noisier because we are using the lunar meshes instead of a uniform grid. However, we can see almost the same behavior as before. This is a different test where the solution is non-regular, and therefore the predicted convergence rate is limited by the non-regularities of the solution. And if one looks back at the proof, it is possible to observe that when the convergence rate is limited by the regularity of the solution, then the coefficient ch over ch can always be neglected. And therefore, we don't see any discrepancy between k test equal 1 on k test equal 2. Then, this is a figure that wanted to explain why we introduced our interpolation. In fact, these are the errors that are obtained for a problem, for a one-dimensional problem with zero forcing term and zero Dirichlet boundary condition on both ends of our one-dimensional domain. On the left, we have the non-interpolated neural network. And as you can see, the error is decreasing with the mesh size. However, the dimension, the solution of this problem is contained in the space in which we are looking for the solution. And therefore, these errors that are different than zero are all spurious modes that cannot be controlled using the loss function. Instead, on the right, we can see that when the neural network is interpolated, we are always below the threshold 10 to the minus 12. That is a threshold, threshold related to the optimizer that we are using to optimize our neural network. And therefore, we cannot go below it, except for the first case with the coarsest mesh. But this is related to the fact that here the interpolation mesh is contains only one element, and therefore the solution is infinity. For this reason, the optimizer that is based on the gradient of the function can optimize much better and is able to go beyond its threshold. However, the important message is that when the network is interpolated, we can control spurious modes, but we cannot do it even in very simple cases when the neural network is not interpolated. Finally, we wanted to analyze why sometimes we can neglect the term CH over CH, while sometimes we cannot. In these four figures, we have two cases with k-test is equal to 1 on the left, and two cases where k-test is equal to 2 on the right. In all the each figure, we have in black the loss function evaluated on the exact solution. In red, we have the loss function evaluated on the interpolation of the exact solution. And in green, we have the loss function evaluated on our numerical solution. In the two figures on the left, we can see that the loss function evaluated on our solution is always much smaller than the other quantities. And this is related to the fact that we are solving a problem that is equivalent to a non-singular squared linear system. Because it is always possible, when k-test is equal to 1, to construct the spaces UH and VH in such a way to obtain two dimensions that coincide. Instead, when k-test is equal to 2, it is not possible to construct the two spaces of the same dimensions, and therefore, in order to have at least as many constraints as degrees of freedom, we have to consider a larger test space, and therefore the solution is sought in a least square sense, and therefore the residuals cannot tend to zero, and as you can see, are always very close to the one of the interpolated solution. If one look back at the proof, it is possible to observe that when the loss function evaluated on the numerical solution is much smaller than the loss function evaluated on the best approximation, that is equivalent to the red dots, then one can neglect that term. And in fact, when k-test is equal to 1, we don't have to consider the term CH over CH. Instead, obviously, the two quantities here are very close, and therefore, when k-test is equal to 2, we have to consider also the coefficient CH over CH and the decrease of exactly one order the predicted convergence rate. With this, I concluded my presentation. We analyzed the interpolated variational physics informed neural network. We provided an a priori error estimate related only to mesh refinements. Up to our knowledge, all our a priori error estimates are always related to the hyperparameters of the neural network and not to the way in which they are trained. Then, analyzing this a priori error estimate, it is interesting to observe that the best convergence rate can be obtained by increasing as much as possible the quadrature rules of order, but decreasing as much as possible, again, the order of the test functions. In this case, they have to be at least equal to 1 because we are considering a second order elliptic problem, but we can choose exactly piecewise linear test functions in order to ensure the best convergence rate. Then we observed that similar convergence rates can be obtained also when the network is not interpolated. This can be interesting sometimes for the practical point of view, but it is not possible to control the spurious modes in this network without changing somehow the loss function or the network architecture. And therefore, that method in general is not reliable. As a future perspective, at the moment we are working on a more complex problem and trying to combine the variational physics from neural networks with domain decomposition techniques. And we are also interested in combining our error estimates that is based on the way in which the network is trained with other estimates that are more related to the network itself. With this, I concluded. The first paper is the one we submitted, and the other three are the main references in the field of variational physics informed neural networks and approximation theory for neural networks with, as in our case, the hyperbolic tangent as activation function. Thank you for the attention.
Let's thank Moreno virtually. And if there are any questions, you can unmute yourself and ask directly to Moreno. Well, I have maybe a warm-up question. When you use the residual on your a priori estimate, do you mean the optimization error? I mean, because during the training procedure of the physics informed neural network, you don't. I mean, you're not guaranteed to get to the actual approximate solution, right? I mean, when you say that exactly the condition RH evaluated on U and N is less or equal than RH evaluated on W and N for every W.
Yes, this one.
Okay, you're not guaranteed that this is true, right? Because you have a training and an optimization procedure with usually a stochastic optimizer, and right? I mean, that is actually the. It's not exactly the residual you get, but and yeah.
Yes and no, in the sense, okay. We don't use. A stochastic optimization, okay. Because usually the stochastic optimization is used when you have a very large data set and you cannot process everything together, or perhaps at least numerically you can take infinite samples in your domain. Instead, in our case, since we fixed a priori the mesh and so the quadrature points that are needed to compute all the residuals, we can use a direct optimization to compute exactly the quantity RH. However, it is true that the optimization problem is non-linear and possibly non-convex, and therefore you cannot say a priori that you are obtaining exactly this inequality. We observed in practice that we can go very close to this because all the error decays are always very smooth and very close to the predicted convergence rate. But in general, this estimate is obtained under this assumption, and therefore also for the global minimum of the manifold represented by the neural network.
Okay.
That
okay,
in general that's... can be different by the numerical solution that one can obtain.
Yeah, yeah.
Then it depends on the optimizer. For instance, we observe that with first order optimizers, in general, this constraint is very hardly satisfied. Instead, with second order optimizers, we obtain the convergence rate I showed you that somehow are able to obtain an inequality very similar to this one.
Okay, thanks. But I mean, in general, you have no way to control it for more complex problems, for example. which have non-local minima are non-linear, non-convex. You have no way to control the optimization error of a neural network, right?
Of the network, no.
Okay.
But here you have also the interpolation. And so you know that if you construct properly your spaces, the minimum is zero because you have a non-singular squared matrix. And so you can control how far you are from it.
Okay, thanks. Are there any questions?
Hi, may I?
Sure, sure.
Hi, Andrea Canzani. Thanks for the talk, Moreno. I couldn't follow very well the setting, so I understand that you need this interpolation because neural network manifold, I think you called it capital UNN.
Yes.
On it, your problem would be imposed, I guess. And I didn't completely understand that, then the cure of it, which comes through this interpolation. If you can say again, so what happens by this interpolation what is the role played by the two meshes in that sense? If I understand correctly, the interpolation happens in the mesh capital H, which is it the coarse one or the fine one?
Yes, the interpolation mesh here is the blue one, the coarsest one. The relation.
Actually, the other way around, your bound there, capital H is greater than or not?
The two meshes have to be compatible. And so you have that capital H can be controlled as by C times a small h, but C is a smaller than
okay.
One.
The
setting is always this.
Okay, yes. Okay, so capital H is the coarse one. Yes, perfect, yeah.
Yes, exactly. And you want this construction in order to have two spaces of the same dimension in practice. However, the role played by the interpolation is...
So, wait a second. So the same dimension, but meaning that so you mean the same number of degrees of freedom?
Yes, they are different because in UH you have piecewise polynomials of order k int on the blue mesh.
Yeah.
Instead, in the other space, you have piecewise polynomials of order k test on the red mesh. But since k test is lower than k int, you can if you refine. Exactly the blue mesh, you can obtain two spaces with the same number of degrees of freedom.
I see.
Even though they are different degrees of freedom, they are
exactly the same number.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And the interpolation is important because the neural network can oscillate in a lot of different ways. Mm-hmm. For example, if I have two points that are two quadrature points that are close to each other, the neural network could oscillate as much as she wants, if it is very large, between these two control points.
Mm-hmm.
But these oscillations are not captured by the loss functions because it only sees the quadrature points.
Yeah.
However, if you interpolate the network, the interpolation cannot oscillate so much because it only sees the interpolation points.
Sure.
And so you are removing all these oscillations that cannot be captured by the loss function but ruin the accuracy of the method.
Okay. Okay, if I may do a, make a follow-up question, then would be then what type so how to compare then this method with, say, because I could then, for instance, think of comparing with like a straight finite element that uses the fine mesh, for instance. I don't know, is there a way to make a comparison or think of what, well, you have of course a theoretical result of convergence, but if you can help our intuition on the type of
yes, at the moment we have not worked on it, and I didn't see also any paper comparing from a theoretical point of view the two approaches. However, I can say that if one is only interested in solving a problem, one should consider classical finite element, spectral element method, or similar, because the solution can be obtained much faster. Mm-hmm. The advantage of using this kind of method is when you have more parameters or you have very complex nonlinearities or very high dimensional problems. So if you are in a setting that cannot be easily managed with classical methods, because otherwise you are slower, because you have to converge to the exact solution in a space in which is very complex to perform a good optimization.
Fantastic. Thanks very much. This is very clear. Thanks.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Sorry, may I ask another one? Do you mind?
Yeah, sure.
You mentioned as your future work looking at the demand decomposition methods. Would you like to tell us something about that?
Yes, we have not worked on it so much. However, the idea is to have a different network in each subdomain, and then to be able to exactly combine them on the interfaces. One idea could be to use operators similar to this one to ensure both the continuity on the interfaces between the two networks and also the continuity of the gradients, for example. However, we are trying different approaches in order to have the network solve a very small subdomain where the solution is easy to compute, and then combine different networks together.
Thanks.
Okay, if there are not any other questions, let's thank again Moreno for the beautiful seminar, a virtual club, and see you for the next AJS seminar. Thank you. In the chat, I will also report some easy detailed instructions for students to subscribe to the SIAM chapter. Thank you very much.